Osborne.
You didn't see that yet.
I'm the Director of ArtWatch International, and I'm going to share a little bit about the organization with you tonight, because I believe many of you are not familiar with it. And it's just wonderful to see new faces and to be able to connect with people around the city and different organizations that are interested in similar issues. A little bit about ArtWatch International. Historic preservation and issues of transparency and careful stewardship of our artistic and historic landscape are inherently linked with the aims of our organization. It was founded when a respected art historian who is pictured here, Professor James Beck, was taken to court for aggravated slander against a harmful conservation treatment upon a significant work of the Italian Renaissance. He ultimately came out the victor, though the opposition was strong and well-connected. In his final statement at the trial, which I will read for you, I think is rather poignant, and I would like to come back to it sometimes when I don't really know what's going on in the world. He writes, or rather he said, "The possibility that the considered observations of art critics and art scholars, or preservationists, should not be aired, or that their judgments need to be cloaked in palliated euphemisms if they are expressed at all, is a dangerous precedent for the principle of free speech and free criticism. If such rights, which are guaranteed by the World Charter of the United Nations and by the constitutions of both the United States and Italy, among others, were qualified, the effect would be chilling, and certainly the true losers would be the art objects of the past and future generations, who have every right to expect to enjoy and learn from the treasures of the culture conserved and preserved in the best manner possible." So this is all to say that as director of ArtWatch, and as well as a curator at a small historic site museum in Manhattan, which you see pictured to my left, which is on East 61st Street if you have not yet been there, I consider it essential to create spaces in which a sincere, open dialogue concerning historic buildings, community needs, and city growth can take place. This enables a more transparent view on situations that are bound to have multiple opinions and vested interests, but which require that we understand the aims and needs of each party involved if we are to see the city develop and flourish. Questioning the aims of change and new development that impact the architectural fabric of a city and how its residents are able to live day to day is, I believe, an essential part of good stewardship of our cultural and artistic heritage, and I believe you all do as well, or else you would not be here. This image I chose because it comes from a period when the 1799 building that is now the museum was surrounded for several decades by gas tanks when the area was very industrial, and it's an arresting image, I think, to just consider a different type of skyscraper that was taking over the skyline in the earlier 20th century. This is from about 1919. The building could have been torn down, but somehow it remained. It's built of Manhattan schist, so that may have been the reason why. It's taken great effort and financial commitment over the years to help preserve it. And this is sort of my entree into considering historic preservation, the impact of landmarks legislation, et cetera, all things we will be discussing tonight, and how it really is constantly in flux, the state of historic preservation in the city. There's always more work to be done. And I really commend groups and individuals who speak up for such efforts and desire to really thoughtfully question how the city can best respond to change and growth. There are people like you are acting on your part as a maker of culture, if you will. I hope that the topics discussed tonight may encourage you that there are others out there desiring to do the same work, to make the same impact, and to ask the same hard questions, and that there is a pressing need to support them. Tonight we'll have Mr. Andrew Berman, the Executive Director of the Greenwich Village Society for Historic Preservation, I guess is his neighborhood, so to speak. Simeon Bankoff, the Executive Director of Historic Districts Council, and Dr. Adam Steinberg, who is a scholar and educator at the Lower East Side Tenement Museum. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Andrew Berman to the stage.
Welcome everybody, and tonight's discussion is about 50 years of historic preservation, what it tells us about the next 50 years. That's a pretty tall order, but in 15 minutes or less, I'm going to try to give it a shot. I figured the best way to do this was to look at the good, the bad, and the challenges, including the progress that we've made over the years. So one of the noteworthy things in thinking about what the last 50 years of historic preservation have been like, especially in this neighborhood, is to look at the expansion of landmark protections in the neighborhood, and it's actually been pretty dramatic. We're gonna look at two slides here. The first one, which is sort of the western half of GBSHP's catchment area, which goes from the Hudson River to the East River. You can see there's that very large Greenwich Village Historic District in the middle. There's a few small historic districts that were designated early in the days of the Landmarks Preservation Commission. Charlton King Van Dam down in the lower left at 1966. McDougal Sullivan Gardens in sort of the lower middle, 1967. The Soho Cast Iron Historic District in 1973. There was a bit of a lull after that, but we saw a very large increase in activity in the 1990s and 2000s. You can see the Gansevoort Market Historic District up in the upper left. The extension of the Greenwich Village Historic District and its far western end in 2006 on the left side of the map, along with the Weehawken Street Historic District. Then in 2010, the Greenwich Village Historic District was extended. Again, if you look in the sort of lower center of the map, it says extension 2 in the kind of South Village part of Greenwich Village. And then in 2013, just to the right of that, you can see it says South Village Historic District 2013. So the historic district protections in the neighborhood have continued to expand, which is very, very important. This map also shows in the various shades of purple individual landmarks in the neighborhood, and they're similarly, and there's just a select few that are neighborhood that are labeled here. There's actually scores of them, but as you can see, some of them were designated in the earliest days of the landmarks law, which took effect in 1965. For instance, in the center left, the archives building on the corner of Christopher and Greenwich, but then if you look to the north, there was the Westbeth complex, which was designated in 2011. In the sort of lower center, the University Village Silver Towers complex in 2008. So there really has been a pretty expansive and continuous growth over the years. Shifting to the east, looking at NoHo and the East Village, actually most of the progress has been in the last 10 or 15 years. The only historic district in the area was the very small St. Mark's Historic District in sort of the center left there. That was designated, pardon the typo, it says 1999, that was 1969, and it was extended a tiny amount, so small that you can't even see it on this map. In 1984, they added two houses. And then you can see the NoHo Historic District in 1999, NoHo East to its lower right in 2003. The NoHo Historic District was then extended in 2008. And then we got the very dramatic expansion east of historic district protections with the East Village Lower East Side Historic District in 2012, and just to the north of Tompkins Square Park, the East 10th Street Historic District. You know, here as well, there were some landmark designations in the earliest days of the commission. Grace Church, up in the sort of upper left in 1966. If you look in the lower part of the map, you can see the New York City Marble Cemetery and the New York Marble Cemetery, both designated in 1969. First houses over on Avenue A, which was actually the very first public housing development in anywhere in the country. That was designated in 1974, but we've also seen some great more recent progress as well. The old PS 64, which was designated in 2006, Webster Hall in 2008 in the sort of upper left, and then just above that, the Van Tassel and Carney Horse Auction Mart, which was the artist Frank Stella's studios for about 2.5 decades. That was designated in 2012. So I know people often feel pessimistic and that all of the great successes were in the very, very distant past. But in fact, in this regard, we have continued to make progress. And another area where we've made some fairly significant progress, and I'm sorry that the underlying background map is a little hard to see here, but we've actually gotten some pretty dramatic changes in the zoning in the neighborhood. Zoning is an incredibly dense and complicated tool for regulating how development takes place in New York, but it's also incredibly important. And one of the most basic things to understand about it is that in most cases, zoning doesn't say how tall a building can be. And it theoretically, in some cases, could allow a building of almost infinite height. That's why in neighborhoods like ours, you want what's known as contextual zoning, which was something that was first implemented in the 1980s, which for the first time put in place height limits, saying specifically buildings cannot be taller than a certain height, and they have to fit a certain envelope that ideally at least matches the neighborhood. So if you look on this map here, these are the areas that we were able to get contextual zoning for, and these are the only areas in this part of Manhattan that have contextual zoning. Almost the entirety of the East Village, which are those two sections over on the right, extending from Avenue D to 4th Avenue, from 14th Street down to Houston Street. And then we got several sections of the Far West Village rezoned with contextual zoning. Those happened in 2005 and then in 2010. Now that vast area in the middle, much of it is in the Greenwich Village Historic District, and that sort of trump zoning in a sense, in that nothing can be built in a historic district until and unless it's approved by the Landmarks Preservation Commission. That said, ideally we'd like to have contextual zoning in those areas as well. But for the non-landmarked areas, the only thing that really helps keep new development in scale is the zoning, and are things like contextual zoning. So that's the good news. Let's talk about the bad news. In recent years, we've seen an increasing permissiveness on the part of the Landmarks Preservation Commission to allow new development changes, arguably out of scale or out of context new development. Now, up until the 1990s, there were actually very, very few new buildings that were approved in landmark districts in Greenwich Village. This was one of the very few, one of the very first. As many of you may know, this took the place of the what's now often referred to as the Weatherman House, or the Weather Underground House, when it exploded in 1970. There was a very, very long battle over what was appropriate to be built here. Some felt that it should be just a recreation of the Greek Revival Road that was there before. Others felt that it needed to in some way mark this break with history that took place. What was ultimately approved was kind of a little of each, as you can see. Elements of the Greek Revival House and the row are maintained, but there is this sort of dramatic shift in the middle that sort of represents this disruption in the history of the block. And here, this on 6th Avenue by Polshek Partners was really the first large new building in the Greenwich Village Historic District in the early 1980s. It was also the subject of an incredible amount of debate and controversy. You can certainly see by looking at it that there were many, in many ways, efforts made to try to reflect historic styles and elements of architecture in it. Certainly by today's standards, this looks remarkably contextual and tame and sensitive and almost bending over backwards to try to recall the character of the neighborhood around it. It was nevertheless incredibly, incredibly controversial at the time. This is a little less sensitive. One of the challenges that we faced is that while we have seen a dramatic expansion of landmark protections in our neighborhood, all too often we find the commission will wait until new developments happen before actually doing landmark designation, so that the, in at least some respects, the horse is already out of the barn. So this was a case as well. Let me say this, I know people who like this building. I'm not a fan of it. You know, I think that's in the eye of the beholder. Nevertheless, there had been a concerted effort to get this part of NoHo landmark for many years, and it was very clear this was a vacant lot, that the commission wanted to wait until the lot was actually developed so that they wouldn't have the power to regulate what was going on, and I think that was a mistake. Here's another example of the commission doing that. So much of the surrounding area here, this is the Hotel Gansport in the Gansport Market Historic District, has since been landmarked. This was also an open lot. GDSHP spearheaded the drive to get this area designated. The commission, it wasn't their slowest case, it wasn't their quickest case either, but they certainly did wait long enough that this site was developed before landmark designation took place, so it's not in the district. I think the neighborhood and the city would have benefited from this being under the guidance of the Landmarks Preservation Commission as opposed to what we got instead. Another example is the Children's Aid Society, a more recent one on Sullivan Street. So this was in an area that we've been pushing for many years to get landmark designation and have gotten landmark designation for, but the commission waited until after this development began. It's actually not the most insensitive development by any means. It could have been a lot worse. That said, the commission seemed to almost intentionally wait until this was already underway before they moved ahead with designation. And here's another example. This is the, here's an example of something similar, which is basically the commission sometimes cutting out development sites and new developments. This is the north side of Houston Street between McDougal and Sullivan Street. We got almost the entire area around here landmarks. They did not want to include this row of buildings in there, and they have two of them have since been knocked down. There actually aren't even architectural renderings available yet, but this is what's going to be going in its place. If you walk by, there's a big sort of gaping lot there. Here's an example of what the commission has approved in historic districts in recent years. People are, now this is the far end of the spectrum. This is not what we usually get, but it is an illustration of what we can sometimes get. People are often shocked to discover that this is in the Greenwich Village Historic District and was approved by the Landmarks Preservation Commission. This is at the corner of 13th Street and Greenwich Avenue. It was also a vacant lot. You know, we certainly thought it was more than appropriate to build a new building here. We would not have said that they need to be mimicking 19th century houses or anything like that. It's very hard to look at this design though and say what it is exactly that they did to try to relate it to the Greenwich Village Historic District. In fact, I would defy anybody to point to a single element of this that seems to in any way be reflective of the historic district within which it is located. Here's another example going on right now. This is on Gansport Street, so up in the upper left is the way it looks now in the landmarked Gansport Market Historic District. On the lower right is what a developer is proposing to build there. Right now it's kind of, the LPC sort of split the difference. They're not going to allow them to build something quite as dramatic as that, but they are going to allow them to tear down one or two buildings and to build significant new additions on top of another one. Here's another angle on the proposal, not what's been approved, because they haven't reached the point of final approval yet. And here's another example. This is on Barrow Street. This was the final design that was approved by the Landmarks Preservation Commission. As you can see, it's next to a row of early 19th century row houses. This was up the parking lot. Here again, certainly we did not feel that it was inappropriate for something to be built there. But the scale and the design, we certainly think was unnecessarily out of character, and unfortunately the commission did not agree. So those are some of the challenges that we face. Other challenges that we face involve a never-ending pushback from the real estate industry against the existing protections that we have. And one example is Intro 775, which I know some of you are familiar with it and have been involved with the fight against it. This is basically a bill in the city council that the real estate industry had a hand in, which would make it much more difficult to landmark buildings and much easier to demolish them. It would impose do or die deadlines for landmark designations, which in some cases, for very legitimate reasons, take a long time to do. The bill would make it so that if the commission doesn't act within a certain limited time frame, the building is automatically not landmarked, or the district, it's automatically deemed unworthy of landmark designation, and it prohibits the commission from coming back to it for a period of 5 years, during which time it can and most likely could, will be demolished. So this is clearly a grave threat preservation efforts. We also are constantly up against the Real Estate Board of New York trying to claim that landmark designation is really counter to the interests of New York City. Interestingly, for decades, their argument was that landmark preservation stifled economic development. Now that that is so blatantly apparently untrue, they've taken the opposite tack, which is to say basically that landmark preservation is so successful that it makes neighborhoods so desirable that they become too expensive for average New Yorkers to live in. And they amazingly, disingenuously have tried to portray themselves as the champion for the underclass in New York, saying that poor New Yorkers are being pushed out of historic districts by virtue of their being landmarked, and that this is something that we need to put a stop to. Certainly we, Historic Districts Council, and a lot of other folks have been pushing back on this, but it's been a meme that has gotten out there and has definitely attracted some attention and adherence. I'd say the other most recent overall threat that we face has been the push from the mayor to change our zoning regulations, one example of which was zoning for quality and affordability. We were able to get some very, very significant changes to it, but there are still some very problematic elements that remained in and were approved by the City Council and now the law. So in some of those areas where we got those zoning protections, they've been loosened somewhat. Originally, they were going to be loosened much more in a much broader way. The way that it worked out in the Far West Village, they're basically intact. In the East Village, they've been loosened for certain kinds of developments to a lesser degree than was originally proposed. But this is also emblematic of the mayor's approach, which is that he has been resistant to any kind of new zoning protections anywhere in New York, and he has only been interested in large-scale upzonings, attaching to them affordable housing provisions, which arguably are important and necessary, but basically saying that the price you have to pay in order to get affordable housing is to allow a massive increase, not just in the size of allowable development, but in the size of market rate or luxury housing that you're going to get at the same time, which arguably would have the effect of actually making neighborhoods less affordable, not more. In conclusion, we still got a long ways to go, even though we've clearly made a lot of progress. There are a lot of areas of our neighborhood that don't have landmark protections that should, that don't have zoning protections that should. Just a block and a half away from here is an incredibly vivid example of that, the old Bullmore site, where a nearly 300-foot-tall tower is going to be going up because that area of the village is not landmarked and does not have contextual zoning. And so we're continuing to push back against that. And I think really the lessons of the last 50 years are that it's a constant fight. It doesn't end. You never get to a point where you can say, all right, it's done, we're safe. Progress clearly only comes from sustained activism, and so it requires a really energized community in order to make it happen, and that there is a constant pushback from the forces of the real estate industry to try to roll back the progress that we've made, and that we have to be incredibly vigilant about that to protect the gains that we have made and to push forward for further gains, and I look forward to doing that with all of you in the years ahead. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrew. Now I'd like to welcome Simeon Bankoff to the podium.
Hi, I'm Simeon Bankoff. I'm the Executive Director of the Historic Districts Council. HDC, very briefly, is about as old as our landmarks law. We're 46 years old. And we originally started as a group of, a coalition of the groups of the immediately created historic districts and those areas who wanted to be historic districts, mostly to campaign for the increased resources for the Landmarks Commission for the integrity of the landmarks law 46 years later, and we continue to campaign for the increased resources for the Landmarks Preservation Commission, which is one of the smallest city agencies there are, and for greater awareness of our preservation efforts. Those are done in three basic program areas. Education, we do lots and lots of community education, about one panel, one walking tour, stuff like that a week, community engagement and outreach, and then direct advocacy, which we are very happy to work with our partners. We are actually our primary constituencies, over 500 neighborhood-based organizations throughout the five boroughs. And whereas Grand Trilogy is lucky enough to have the GDSHP, which is the largest membership organization in the village, most of these groups are still kitchen table groups made of volunteers who volunteer their time, and so we try to provide them with the services that they don't have otherwise. So let's talk about the landmarks law. Now, you can kind of see.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Now, this is 50 years of landmarking. This is, you can't quite tell from this very poor map. But as you can see, it's kind of clustered down the very, that little nebula of cluster is Lower Manhattan. And then what you really can't see on that map at all is Staten Island. But there are one or two little dots. Those aren't mistakes. About 3.5% of the city is landmarked after 50 years. Okay? That does sound like a lot, but let's put some numbers on that. So this is actually a chart from 50 years of landmarking, of what the Landmarks Commission has managed to do. The colors separate them by the different mayoralties, by the different administrations. So you know, all the way very, very 1965 is the last year of the Wagner administration. And then you've got Lindsay Beam, Koch, Dinkins, Giuliani, Bloomberg, and then the last one, because this is just data from 2014, is de Blasio. Even in the best of years, they were not designating a lot. I mean, there's this sort of myth that the landmark preservation is out of control, that this is so much, but, right? That's not the bar. Anyway. So what does that actually mean also in terms of square footage? You know, really, this comes out to, it's 2.5% of square footage within the historic districts. I'll get to where the other 1% comes from. And with regards to square footage, that's 140 million square feet is regulated by the Landmarks Preservation Commission, which sounds like an awful lot, but really, at the end of the day, it is about 34,000 buildings out of a total universe of a million. Here are the individual landmarks. Now that's a little better in terms of buildings that have been deemed as appropriate to look for and for all of us to cherish for the all of eternity. Again, there is a color code that has to do with the mayoralties. But let's move to this is a chart that shows how things are happening. As you can see, what happened in 1965 was there was this pent-up need, this pent-up desire to protect our heritage. So you got a lot of action going on, right? It's like I always think of it as the first novel effect. You have all these ideas and you want to jam it into your first novel, and the second novel comes and you're like, not sure. So you have sort of a sophomore slump, and then you have a further slump as time goes on. Yeah. Now remember, think about the city. Think about what the city was in 1965 versus what the city was in 2015. You know? And then we also have that's the additional 1%. Just showing the square footage, really kind of putting some numbers in it. Now, one of the things to understand is that there is an enormous amount of disparity in that market, in terms of geographic disparity. That, of course, Manhattan was always gifted with the most gifted architects and actually the largest amount of money and the largest amount of resources to build the grand institutions. And much of Manhattan is extraordinarily worthwhile, but outside of Manhattan, you really don't have that much that's preserved. And as my organization is citywide, what we've been doing for the last, we created a program called the Six to Celebrate 6 years ago, and we started working, really trying hard to sort of extend the benefits of preservation outside of Manhattan, to bring both attention to those neighborhoods and to help out those groups, those kitchen table groups, who don't necessarily have protection. So, one group is Inwood. Now, this map over here, you can see the dark blue are actually the historic districts. So you have up there in the Bronx, you've got Riverdale, and then down over there, you're starting as you're going down to the lower left corner, you're seeing the tip, you're seeing, you know, a little bit of the Upper West Side. But Inwood has been historic districts. It's a beautiful area, I don't know if anyone knows it. And here's some of the buildings of Inwood. It's got some absolutely beautiful Art Deco, some very interesting, that's a very interesting train station over there in the middle over there. I'm sorry, I apologize for that. But for on the lower right, it's actually got stair steps like in Italy or in San Francisco, where actual stair steps that you have to walk up the street on stairs. Again, these are completely unprotected. We worked with a group up there, continue working with them, to try to gain recognition. No one had ever done a full survey of the area. Now, one of the concerns is that, and we will be getting back to this a couple of times, is that Inwood is one of the areas that our mayor, that Andrew was speaking of, the zoning plan, they need to upzone. That it is going to be one of the areas that we need to, that the mayor has decided to sort of target to deal with the housing crisis. Another area that, you know, the mayor is choosing to target for the housing crisis is East Harlem. Again, you can see, even within Manhattan, it is, by the way, I'm moving from south, from north to south as we go through. There you have the dark blue over there, immediately next to the arrow, is the Upper East Side and Carnegie Hill, which is one of the larger historic districts in New York. But then there's this enormous section that is completely unprotected, an enormous section, which in a very dark pictures, you can see you've got wonderful churches, tenement buildings, institutional buildings, and murals, these wonderful murals that have become more and more prominent, reflective of the Latin culture and the Caribbean culture down there. Now, murals are another thing that actually landmarking can't save, even though they're very much a part of the city and that people want to protect them. Sometimes we're lucky enough to get murals like in Soho that are part of the historic district, but by and large, the Landmarks Commission allows them to be repainted. And this is yet another thing, as we're looking at sites of cultural importance in the next 50 years, how do we save these things? How do we save the ephemeral traces of new cultures? Again, also, by the way, East Harlem is yet another area that's going to be upzoned. Bedford-Stuyvesant, actually, this is a better story because we have been working with them pretty closely for the last 10 years. And, because this is a current map, we actually got a lot of that historic district. If this was a map from 5 years ago, you would not have seen that many dark blue historic districts there, those protected areas. But Bed-Stuy really is simply some of the most gorgeous row house and institutional architecture in New York City. Just rows and rows and rows and rows, streets and streets and streets of beautiful Romanesque Revival, Italian Revival buildings that, because of various and sundry discriminatory mortgage practices in the mid 20th century, we never actually had the investment to ruin them. Sometimes actually economy is the worst thing for people who really care about architectural preservation. This was actually a community driven project. They came to us and they said there had been studies done but no one ever did anything. What can we do? And we worked with the area. You see some of the people over there at the bottom with their landmark Bedford-Stuyvesant Now posters. And we worked with the Landmarks Commission, who was very receptive to the notion of revisiting the area, revisiting and trying to get above, in front of the wave of the new development that was coming into the area. That was another area that also got contextually rezoned, as Andrew talked about it. Unfortunately, some of those rezonings, some of those protections have been loosened in the recent ZQA. Okay, as I said, we're moving south. So Gowanus. Now you see that all that blue is the Brooklyn Brownstone area, Park Slope, and Brooklyn Heights. Those are old historic districts, and I hope at least many of you have pictures in your mind of what they look like. But the Gowanus area is extraordinarily old. It's, I could talk about the Native Americans, but I shan't. But it is a 19th century industrial area that grew up.
and is completely unprotected and is now ground zero for the Sanders campaign. Now, actually, it's ground zero for development, that the city's pushing very hard to develop it for high-rise or even medium-rise residential. Of course, it does happen to be on a Superfund site, and cancer rates are pretty high, but that's not stopping the developers. And here are some of the remaining beautiful 19th century, early 20th century industrial buildings and residential buildings of Gowanus. It does look picturesque. You don't want to touch that water. It's very, very good. But these are all examples. I mean, it's historically polluted, but a lot of these buildings are being reused. Light manufacturing is still going on there. People still live there. And they're all very much at risk, because none of them are protected. Moving over to East New York, which most people can't find on a map, frankly. This is the first piece of the mayor's rezoning, what's gonna happen. And East New York, it was kind of terra incognita for a lot of people. It's all the way to kind of, I can't find it. So the green over there is Prospect Park. East New York is kind of near Cypress Hills, and that's those are cemeteries. It's past Bushwick, it's past Brownsville, and it's pretty much almost into Queens. It's one of the poorest districts of the city, but historically it actually has a great deal in it in terms of its architecture. And again, it has a community who feels strongly about it. And these are some of the buildings in East New York that are at risk. The city has they just recently, last few weeks ago, they upzoned the area. And for example, that onion domed church, that Byzantine church over there, a very large apartment building could go right in front of it and block it. It's very prominent, it's on a corner, but it's got an empty lot. And there's some real concerns. The Masonic, that sort of weirdly Grecian bank building also could easily be replaced. And then finally, Far Rockaway, just to take us all the way to the south. Far Rockaway, as people may or may not know, in the early 20th century, Far Rockaway was the playground of the working class, that there were thousands upon thousands of bungalows that New Yorkers of humble means or working people would rent out for the holidays and rent out for the summer. And just go and hang out, vacationing in New York, why not? We do live on the water, after all. The Rockaways, however, development came in, and what had been rows and rows, literally tens of thousands of bungalows, were demolished in the mid-century. There is a very small section, which is where Far Rockaway is, that survived. It's really only about three blocks worth of these little bungalows. Shockingly and wonderfully, they actually survived Superstorm Sandy quite well. They were, because the community cares so much, that they actually built up the berm and the beach, so that when the water came, it actually didn't come out of the ocean, it actually came from the other side, from the bay, up Seeker Avenue. But many of the buildings are slightly elevated, so I heard a lot of complaints about, I got water in my building, but like the rest of the Rockaways, it's destroyed. And these are this is actually one of the Astor Foundation's projects in the late 1980s, was giving the Beachside Bungalows Association, Preservation Association of New York, a bit of money to try to preserve these bungalows, and they've been at it now for 30 years, and yet they are getting no response from the city. So these are all areas that the city still needs to focus on. In the next 50 years, we need to sort of move away from, we need to do a better job of protecting what we actually have designated. We need to protect what's outside the core. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Simeon. We have one more speaker, and then I will invite everyone back up for what I'm sure will be an interesting panel of questions. So while I pull this presentation up, I would like to invite Dr. Aaron Steinberg, please.
okay?
Yeah.
Good. I have a PhD in geography from Rutgers University, and the subject of my dissertation was historic preservation on the Lower East Side. I also work at the Lower East Side Tenement Museum, where I manage the museum's neighborhood walking tour program. As a social scientist who studies historic preservation and as somebody who works for a public history institution, I've become familiar with what some academics have been saying or writing about historic preservation, which is why I'm here. I'm going to share with you. I'm going to share with you what academics do say about historic preservation based on my literature review. I'm also going to share with you my research findings from a case study I did about a proposed landmark district on the Lower East Side. And then I'll conclude, I'm such a social scientist, I'm going to conclude by talking about next steps for academics and preservationists. One of the things I've learned in graduate school is that almost everything an academic says is in response to something else an academic said. So if you're going to write an article, it has to respond to another academic's argument. Maybe you're agreeing, maybe you're disagreeing, maybe you're building upon, but it's always part of that discussion. Based on what I learned from my literature review of academic articles about historic preservation, most of these academics are responding to and rejecting one of two arguments. The first of those arguments is that real estate controls New York. And for those of you who don't know, these three gentlemen are the stars of a reality show called Million Dollar Listing New York, and they are real estate agents. And if you are ever curious to see what it's like to buy or sell a multi-million dollar home in New York, there they are. And in my subfield of urban geography, this comes up a lot. It's a very sort of Marxist, neo-Marxist, Marxist-humanist idea that capital controls everything. Maybe it's not as direct as Marx himself said, but this comes up a lot. David Harvey, who's kind of the father of contemporary urban geography, is a purveyor of this theory. So is Neil Smith, the late, great Neil Smith, who was the chair of the Rutgers Geography Department and later taught at CUNY. They both describe how neoliberalism has reshaped the American city. Neoliberalism, I think David Harvey would describe as the belief that the market is the ideal model for all social interaction. Not just for buying and selling things, but for everything. And so they say that this is sort of capital seeping into all social interactions. But if that's true, how did we end up with the LPC? And one of my favorite articles that is a counter to this idea that capital controls everything is Eric Allison's review of how the landmarks law got passed. And this is a 20-year-old article, but it's a wonderful read for anybody who's curious about the background. And basically, what Allison found was that the real estate lobby deplored the idea of a landmarks law, but they also were incredulous. They couldn't believe this thing would ever pass. And they really just assumed it wouldn't. They didn't take it seriously. They were, as Allison writes, just so kind of arrogant and smug that they just didn't see it coming. And then when it finally came, and it was like coming up for a vote, it was too late. They couldn't organize against it. And then they said, oh, the courts will knock it down. They were wrong. And now they're stuck with this landmarks law that they really didn't want. And the big takeaway here is that the opponents of capital can actually succeed. That sometimes, you know, capital lets its guard down. And if you are, say, a neighborhood activist or a historic preservationist, if you're smart, you can take advantage of those moments where the capital real estate lobby sort of makes these tactical errors. So that's one argument, counter-argument, but most of the things I read written by academics about historic preservation were countering a different argument. Basically, the idea that historic preservation is wonderful, and that it's an unalloyed public good. And there are some academics, especially historians, who really, really are very critical about that idea. So I'm going to dispassionately go through some of these counter-arguments. I like that cartoon. That drawing for me is just so perfect. So basically, what these historians have been saying in their historical reviews of the historic preservation movement is that the historic preservationists are too narrow. They are too rigid in their thinking, and they need to put their own movement in historical context if they're really going to live up to the social justice meaning of what historic preservation should be about. And I'm going to go through, this is kind of complicated, I'm going to go through these one by one through talking about a few of these articles and what they said. First off, we're going to talk about Ned Kaufman for a moment. So, Ned Kaufman, in a 2009 essay, Historical Memory, Social Equity, and the Disappearance of New York's Working Class Neighborhoods, critiques what he describes as a historic preservationist tendency to be too bounded in their thinking, literally bounded. And he says that the historic preservation movement really missed an opportunity in the 1980s when they started switching over from focusing so much on historic sites and moving toward historic districts, that they really missed an opportunity to kind of expand the idea of historic. His argument is that a building, say, first houses, right? That's a bounded site. It has boundaries. It has outer walls. It begins and it ends. But he says that districts aren't bounded. I mean, we give them boundaries. That's the way the law is written, right? But your life and your life and your life, you don't respect those boundaries. If you're a stakeholder in that district, you'll cross in and out. And people who care about what's going on in those districts, he argues, they perceive the problems facing those districts, for example, the lack of affordable housing, as extending well beyond the district. And the solutions they look for extend well beyond the district as well. So what Kaufman says is that because the districts are so carefully bounded, in the same way a site is, the historic preservation movement is missing an opportunity to kind of think almost literally outside the box. I just came up with that. So that's one critique. And another one that comes up is also, I'm going to do a quick quote here from his article. This is actually, I think, really significant. He ends the article by writing, "Few community planners and affordable housing advocates found it natural to seek common ground with preservationists. Few preservationists found it natural to make common cause with advocates for communities like Greenpoint and Harlem." And he says that's basically because of the boundedness of districts that is too rigidly defined. Another kind of critique that comes up from historians about historic preservation is about the very meaning of the word historic. Cameron Logan, in his study of the Battle of the Landmark, the Shaw neighborhood of Washington, D.C. Anybody here from Washington? Shaw is kind of right next to DuPont Circle, traditionally African-American. Anyway, he argues that the conventional wisdom in the press back then was that this was an example of white gentrifiers who were well-meaning, kind of moving into this African-American neighborhood and then wanting to gentrify, and wanting to designate it, and then the sort of parochial African-American community fighting against it. So the way it was described in the press, the local press, was that this was kind of white, middle-class, upper-middle-class versus black working class. He went deep into what happened in the battle over the designation of Shaw. He argues it was much more complicated than that. And he found that ultimately it wasn't about white versus black. It wasn't about upper class versus middle or lower class. He said that the conflict ultimately was about social power. This is what he writes. "The conflict over Shaw highlighted the absence of any agreement about what constituted the historicity." Historicity? I mispronounce words all the time. Historicity, because I read all the time, I never talk. Historicity of such a historic area, and cast doubt over who might be qualified to speak on behalf of the history contained in such an area. The story of what happened around DuPont Circle reveals that the capacity and entitlement to say that a place is historically significant and thereby protected is a form of social power. So what he's kind of getting at is that there's no historic. It's really just about who's going to have power over the identity of this neighborhood. The people in that neighborhood want to preserve that power. And other people were supposedly trying to exert their power over it. Rather pointed critiques, but brace yourself. I am now going to talk about the historian who's the most harshly critical about historic preservation, and that is Randall Mason. Randall Mason wrote several articles and book chapters over the last decade, doing what I would describe as taking historic preservationists to task for being too narrowly focused on buildings. And this is something he writes. The historic preservation movement has become, quote, "so focused on building preservation for its own sake that it verges on taxidermy of cultural artifacts, propping up the dead facsimiles of the past." Nice. He also goes on to say that the solution is for preservationists to better understand their own history. So he says, "the ahistorical attitude toward the evolution of the field abets the preservationist aversion to reflection and self-criticism." Ouch. He goes into more detail in other articles. But basically he says, okay, historic preservationists today, this is his argument by the way, historic preservationists today, they think their movement began in the 1960s. They are wrong. He traces the roots of the historic preservation movement to the progressive movement in the 1890s and early 1900s. So his argument that that's the real birthplace of historic preservation. Progressive movement, quick history lesson, big messy movement, but basically it was a response to the rapid industrialization and growth of New York City. You have all these slums growing and all these corrupt political machines and all this pollution, major industrial pollution, and you know, kids scampering on the street, homeless, and it's all just terrible. So these progressives come along and they say, what we need are objective people with proper training to plan. That if you could just see the city as a whole and plan holistically, then you could solve these problems. You could help New York live up to its potential as a newly industrializing city. So the progressives were all, they thought big. So they said, let's create a network, a transportation network. We're gonna build bridges, we're gonna build subways, we're gonna build streetcars, we're gonna have it all be interlinked. Let's build an integrated five-borough-wide public school system with its own citywide school curriculum. The very first school curriculum citywide was 1903. And that way, these kids, if they move, they'll get the same education, right? They're not starting over in a different kind of school with a different curriculum. And wherever they're going, they're gonna be taught how to be good Americans, because these are immigrants who obviously don't know how to be American. That was their point of view. They created networks of parks and playgrounds throughout the city. And this is his main takeaway, they also created what he describes as a memory network. They created heritage sites throughout the city. Now, these were not created by the city themselves. This is before the city had the power to designate landmarks. This was a kind of privately done, saying, these are the important sites of heritage, and we're going to spread them out through the city, so that just that you are always within walking distance to a subway station, and your kid is always in walking distance to a school, you will always be in walking distance to a heritage site that's going to inspire you to be a better kind of American, to live up to the civic ideals, right, and not vote for Tammany, or whatever they were kind of going for. His main point is this, I'm actually read this quote. The movement was not a negative response to modernity. There I go again, right? But very much a modern movement, not a way to protect certain sites from development, but of a piece with the development of a city. And he basically argues that by taking out historic preservation from all the other elements of the city, by using it to try to kind of stop development, which is his argument, historic preservationists today are now cutting themselves off from their own roots of what their movement is about and what it can be about. Oh boy. Okay, so these are harsh critiques, and I can't help but wonder whether or not any of these historians actually spoke to any living, real historic preservationists while they were doing their research. And if they did not, okay, I can give them a break. They're historians, that's not really what they do. But I will say that based on another literature review, there does seem to be some basis for this argument that historic preservationists exist separately from other areas of urban planning. So Stephanie Ryberg-Webster and Kelly Kennahan, they did a literature review of academic articles that link historic preservation to other fields of study. They didn't find many. By the way, neither did I when I was working on my dissertation, but that's another story. They wrote, we conclude that while there are many practical synergies between the fields, preservation research and advocacy largely exists in a silo that is disconnected from the dominant urban policy discourses of the early 21st century. For preservation to retain its relevance as an urban strategy, scholars and practitioners must understand how current preservation practice is or is not advancing urban development when disconnects exist, and how preservation policy can adapt to meet 21st century needs. And let's be upfront about this, they are also taking the stance that historic preservation should be a part of other planning ideals, including growth. And that's not necessarily a given, but that's their point of view. And it is true that when I was doing my literature review for my dissertation in my field of geography, I found surprisingly few geographers who had really seriously studied historic preservation. I had a lot of trouble with that historic literature review. So this seems to go both ways, that the literature isn't necessarily speaking to each other across fields. You're all with me so far? Mm-hmm. I was speaking very quickly. How much time do I have? 10 minutes? Okay, good. So, now I want to talk about my research. So the this is actually, you guys already showed this. This is the Lower East Side, and boy, is it looking kind of blank. I actually created a map, not nearly this well done, 10 years ago for the museum, and it was even more apparent back then. This is a neighborhood that is relatively under landmarked. So I did a case study about the Tenement Museum, which proposed a landmark district for this neighborhood back in 2006-2007. This is that proposed district. It was the best map I could find. So they never really got a better map going. They changed the boundaries a lot, by the way. So I had three research questions. Why did the Tenement Museum pursue landmark designation? What did it try to do to get landmark designation? And why did it fail? And they did fail. I had three methods. I did archival research at the Tenement Museum, going through all the records. I did a newspaper review of local press, English and Chinese language. No, I do not speak Chinese. Just not some good English translations, about this proposal. And I did 28 in-depth and confidential interviews of involved stakeholders. These included former employees of the Tenement Museum. These included landlords, developers, community activists, historic preservationists. And these interviews, I applied something called responsive interviewing, which aims to help me as a researcher understand the point of view of these stakeholders. You know, why did they think they did the things they do? How did they define culture? How did they define historic? So that was really my goal, to kind of see things from the point of view of these 28 people, and through that, try to get a better understanding of why, for example, this proposal failed. And I want to tell you what I found out. So, okay, up front I can say there were some reasons they failed that were strictly unique to the historic, to the Tenement Museum. They were not generalizable. There were some reasons that were also unique to just kind of cultural public history institutions. Those are generalizable, but I'm gonna skip over those. The biggest reason that I discovered for why the museum failed to get a landmark district is because in the eyes of many of the neighborhood stakeholders, the proposed district didn't do anything or enough to deal with their biggest concern, which was displacement.
Is what?
Displacement. So we're talking about 2006, Lower East Side, gentrification is going on like crazy. I'm going to define gentrification as a social scientist. Gentrification is the return of an outside investment to a neighborhood that previously lacked it, thus resulting in the displacement of a class of residents and their replacement by a higher class of residents. Right? So there's two. I say that a lot, actually. I'm always defining gentrification, but it's a two-part process, right? Money's coming back in, and then poor people are being pushed out. There can be a racial component to this, but it's not necessarily racialized, so keep that in mind. So that's been going on in the Lower East Side since really the 1990s. And so a lot of people in the neighborhood, they're holding on for dear life to their apartments. There are a lot of renters in that neighborhood. They're being harassed by landlords. They're seeing their favorite stores closing. Their churches and Buddhist temples are having to relocate. Their employers are having to relocate. So that's our biggest concern, displacement. And historic preservation didn't seem to address that. Now, I want to talk a little bit about why they believe that, and I actually think they might be onto something here. So, first of all, the Lower East Side is definitely historic. Based on the objective criteria of the law, I don't see how you can argue that one of the oldest residential neighborhoods in New York can't be historic, that the first immigrant enclave, arguably in America, can't be historic, that a neighborhood that arguably was the birthplace of American Judaism can't be historic, that a neighborhood that still has scores of 19th century tenements, as well as cast iron buildings and row houses, how can that not be historic? The criteria were there. Also, the Tenement Museum did everything historic preservationists told them to do. They consulted with historic, I mean, they're not a historic preservation organization, but they consulted, oh, by the way, when I began my research, I received a waiver from the museum for a right of review, which means that they had no say over any of this. So this all was done independently of the museum, even though I was an employee of the museum. Okay, now I'm back. So they did everything the historic preservationists told them to do. They crossed all their T's, they dotted all their I's. They also did everything the historians were saying they were supposed to do. They were going out to the neighborhood, they were talking to the community, they were trying to do grassroots activism, they were trying to make this a grassroots movement. So they were trying to do everything they were told to do, and it still failed. The reason why I believe they failed, ultimately, is not just that the stakeholders didn't see a way to help stop displacement. Beyond that, it's about the LPC and the landmarks law. So the LPC has limited funds and staff. We talked about this earlier. And that means that it really can't review every qualified proposal it receives. It has to pick and choose. And it prefers, generally, to pick and choose, for calendaring for hearings, proposals that have strong community grassroots support and minimal opposition from landlords. It doesn't always work that way, but it usually does. The Tenement Museum found that the Lower East Side didn't have either of that. It didn't have strong community support, and it did have a lot of landlord opposition. So why were locals so indifferent? Why did they believe that it wouldn't protect them from displacement? Look at it this way. Let's say you work for an organization on the Lower East Side representing one of the communities down there. You have limited resources. You have limited funds. You have limited time. You have to pick your fights. And the people I spoke to at these organizations basically said, you know what, we'll sign a letter, but we're not going to do more than that because we don't see how this district is going to help us deal with our main mission. Now, as for the landlords, oh boy. So, you own a tenement on the Lower East Side. Your grandfather bought it in, I don't know, 1910, and back in the 1970s, you couldn't give it away. Right? Your neighbors were tearing down their tenements or not paying taxes, and the land was going to the city. Now, suddenly, all this big corporate money's coming in, and you see Shlomo down the street, and that sounded so anti-Semitic. A lot of them were Jewish, though. You see Shlomo down the street making millions selling his tenements to a developer who's going to build a high-rise luxury condo, and then there was another one. That guy's selling his air rights so that they can build a high-rise luxury hotel. Maybe this can happen to you, too. At the very least, banks, after 2000, were finally willing to make loans to landlords to upgrade their buildings. So landlords in this neighborhood saw the district as a barrier between them and potentially millions of dollars in profits after having spent decades sitting on these buildings that they couldn't give away. So there was a very fraught community board hearing about this proposed district, and many, many landlords showed up, and they were very, very angry. And there were very few people showing up in support of the district. The museum did go back to those landlords and try to get them on board, but eventually the landlords were like, no, we're not going to help you create this district. Oh, so what are the conclusions here? I do think the city's landmark law is too narrow a tool to address the pressing concerns facing low and income but gentrifying neighborhoods. It's just not designed to help preserve affordable housing directly. It might do so, but it's not the main purpose of the law. The law does not empower the LPC to do that. There are other departments and agencies of the city that are responsible for affordable housing, but the LPC is not empowered to work with housing preservation and developers. In a sense, the academic critics are right in critiquing the historic preservation movement for being too narrowly focused on objectively identifying bounded historic sites, but I think they're missing the point. Marjorie Pearson, in her history of the landmarks law and the LPC, she says that when the law was being written, the people who wrote it and the people who later staffed the LPC, they were very frightened, and justifiably so, of legal challenges. This is America. Property rights are sacrosanct, right? How dare you? So they wrote a very cautious law with a strong preference for clearly defined objective criteria, a very technocratic kind of law. And when they staffed the LPC, they made certain to avoid landmarking sites or districts that might trigger a major lawsuit that could conceivably lead to a court striking down the law. It was something that just haunted them for years and years, and I would argue still haunts them to this day. It is still an underfunded, understaffed agency, and they are constantly on the defensive. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about next steps here. Donovan Rukima, by the way, I'm not a revolutionary, so I'm not going to say we should get rid of capitalism. Donovan Rukima, back in 2002, wrote a report for the National Trust for Historic Preservation suggesting some fairly simple policy reforms that could conceivably allow for the creation or protection of some affordable housing through historic preservation. For example, you could revise the federal low-income housing tax credit, so that it preferences the preservation of old properties. But I am not a policymaker, I am a social scientist. So I will conclude this presentation the way most social scientists conclude everything and suggest that we need more research. I got to come up with something else for you to do. I think we do need to know more about how historic district designation affects rent, sale prices, and demographics. And we also have to really understand the causation here, not just the correlation. Causation, correlation is not causation, right? You all know that from statistics. So we might find out that certain districts have become wealthier since designation, is that because of designation? That's very hard to prove. But I think more research could help us understand whether or not it does lead to displacement after all, or perhaps whether it could be used to fight it. I would also love to see more of those interviews I was talking about. More interviews with historic preservationists and with stakeholders at the local level so that we can better understand how people who live in these neighborhoods feel and think about things like what is historic and how it should be protected. Those kind of deep qualitative interviews is kind of what I love to do most, so I'm gonna say we really need those a lot. It's very self-serving, but it's true, I think they're great. Thankfully though, it looks like, thankfully though, it looks like the historic preservation movement is already moving in this direction. Just as I was working on, you can't possibly see what that's supposed to be. Just as I was working on this presentation, I received the most recent issue of Preservation Magazine, the magazine of the National Trust for Historic Preservation. And there is Fighting Displacement, the editor's note at the beginning, talking about how the NTHP's Preservation Green Lab has been doing research that has found that preservation does not necessarily lead to displacement. It's a start, and an important one. I have one final thing to say here, though. I think that this is an area of discussion that could use a little more humility from some people. I have read some preservationists and the things they write that sometimes suggest to me that they do treat preservation like an end rather than a means to an end. I think that's unfortunate. But more importantly, I think that some of these academics may not be giving enough credit to the sophistication of preservationists or the institutional constraints they face as they try to pursue what I think we can all agree truly is a public good, which is the preservation of at least part of our shared cultural heritage. Thank you.
To invite our speakers back up to take one of these three seats and some water if you have dogs on. So I wanted to start off with maybe a question or two to sort of poke the bear, so to speak, and then ask the panelists if they have thoughts about each other's presentations, and then also make sure we have some time for you all to ask them some questions. So something that I noticed about the way that each of these discussions of historic preservation, where it has been, where it is right now, and where it could go, sort of bring out the two, I guess, motives for preservation. One is perspectives on it is the economic, and then also, the benefits that historic preservation has for communities, for the people engaging with these buildings. And something that I wanted to ask is, if I can find it, I think each of you have had experience with success stories of working within a community, with individuals. Can you expand a little bit about the just what is the role of personal stories, of testimonials? How do you measure the success of that community engagement that is so, you know, can cannot happen in many situations and can make historic preservation in an area fail, or can really make a difference? Can, you know, community organizations really be called upon HDC to do work in Bed-Stuy? And I know the Chief HHP is also involved with their communities as well. And so that's something that I kind of wanted to discuss, because historic preservation, in the way that I approach it, is it's about knowing your city and what's there and working at a historic site. I'm constantly having to answer the question, why are we relevant in our grant proposals, and, you know, convincing people that it's important that we're here and they come visit us and they that we remain here and we don't sell our air rights, heaven forbid. So I want to open that up to you all. Please take it away.
Sure. Well, I certainly, can you hear? I certainly think that stories are important, and most importantly, as I think we would all agree and in some ways hit on in our presentations, you can't really be successful at this unless you have community investment in what you are trying to do and buy-in. And generally speaking, a big component of that is people feeling a sense of personal connection to these places, to these communities, to what they mean, to what the history means, to why they are important. And it's also very rare that you have a designation, whether it's an individual site or a district, where there isn't a clear story that's attached to it. I think almost any one of these places that we've fought to get landmarked or fought to preserve, you could easily sum up what the story is about them, whether it's Bedford-Stuyvesant or Greenwich Village, or, you know, even, you know, I cited the IMA concrete pinwheel towers that we, silver towers that we got landmarked. Whether you love them or hate them, there's a very clear story that you can tell about what they are about and why they're there and what their meaning is. And I think that that is an essential component of historic preservation, and it's completely interwoven with it. I mean, if there wasn't a story, there'd really be nothing to fight for and nothing to preserve.
And I also agree, and I think that Adam's reading of my dear friend Randy Mason is kind of amusing, because Randy spent the last 20 years saying the same thing, and it's a little unfair. But part of the whole story, what Andrew was talking about, is not only the history of the site, but the history of the story of trying to save the site. That when you go back, and I've been in this field long enough, unfortunately, to be able to say, oh yeah, you know, 14 years ago when we were fighting over this building. And that becomes part of the whole story of the community, of how people made friends, how people know each other, how people make decades-long relationships, or don't go to a particular bar because that guy testified against something once. There is a wonderful wine store in the South Street Seaport I refuse to set foot in. And that actually creates in a community building that reflects back that it comes from a sense of community and it builds that sense of shared purpose.
I just want to add to that. I don't have experience, obviously, with successful historic designation. But I will say this much about the Lower East Side. You mentioned stories, the story we tell about a space. The Lower East Side differs from some other neighborhoods that get designated in that it is riven by certain class, racial, ethnic, and religious divisions. And that makes it difficult to tell a story about that neighborhood when you have Jewish stories, Latino stories, African-American stories, you know, Chinese stories, and those stories, it can be a turfed out neighborhood, as one interview subject explained to me. I suspect that one of the reasons that that neighborhood has a PC4 designation, and this did not come up directly with my interviews, it's just based on my understanding of the neighborhood, is that it's not a neighborhood that lends itself to easy storytelling about it as a place by the people who live there.
Well, it's a place that's aggressively proud of its own history, but I think the history is very balkanized. And
right.
I think also that one of the elements of that history is leading it. That a lot of people move to Lower East Side and then leave.
Yeah,
it's a starting place.
True.
So
true.
So then if you go back and you're attempting to sort of do a nostalgia routine, you're going to offend the people who are there right now because you're sort of talking
right.
about the good old days. Like when we were joking earlier, and I was like, oh, you should do a you should do a site, you know, a historic room, a decorated room from the early 1990s, which everyone thought was really cool. You know, which would probably offend everybody who was there in the early 2000s who thought it was much cooler then. And, you know, really offend everybody who was there in the 1980s when they really had real junkies, and, you know, et cetera. So, I mean, like, it's a situation where it is one of the characteristics of the Lower East Side as an area is that you get in and then you move out.
And I would add to that a lot of people don't move out and never moved out, and sometimes it was because they were too poor.
Right.
So that becomes something that's like the Jewish community didn't want to necessarily acknowledge, that there were poor Jews that were left behind.
Compare that, for example, to Chinatown, which has an extraordinarily long history as an immigrant with different kinds of Asian immigrant populations, but that have truly transformed the area in a way, in a different way than I think the Lower East Side did. In terms of the physical creations in the area, physical also ownership of the area.
Well, how do you mean? I mean, what?
In Chinatown, I think that you had successive populations that would build on each other's continued success, and also even when you had Asian populations, Asian immigrant populations moving out, there was still a deep connection, more than just Russell Brothers.
I think at the end of the day, the fatal flaw for the Lower East Side effort was that, you know, this, as to use Simeon's term, this was a uniquely balkanized community. And it had been a very, very long time before anybody had been able to advance any sort of city policy in that neighborhood. I mean, it was really unique in those divisions. And the landmarking proposal, not only did it not, it didn't even land with one of the groups and then have the other groups opposing it, it didn't land with any of the groups. So everybody was against it. So it never took off in terms of having a constituency, which is a shame because it's clearly, you know, there's few places as laden with history as the Lower East Side, and a lot of it has been lost, and had there been landmark designation, less of that would have been lost. Which is really a shame.
And just to add to that, the people at the Tenement Museum who were pushing for landmark designation, they were well aware of this balkanization, and they thought they could transcend it because they're not associated with any one community. But precisely because they weren't associated with any one community, it was hard for anyone to take it too seriously.
Right. So instead of everybody trusting them, nobody trusts
them. Yeah.
And I'll use as a contrast, for example, in Harlem, often when I'm working in Harlem, people say, well, why isn't the whole area landmark? How can we need to landmark the whole area? And that's actually because there's sort of a shared feeling, regardless of when you moved to Harlem, be it like 5 years ago or 50 years ago, that there's more of a collective feeling that may be an imagined collection. But I don't feel the Lower East Side. Everyone is the Lower East Side, more of like, I got my Lower East Side.
Thank you. From my end of things, thinking about the role of historic sites and historic museums, which the landmarking of them and the preservation of them is a, you know, let's not open that can of worms. But I'm thinking about we're discussing the sort of failed attempt of a historic site to sort of thinking that they're advocating, you know, very optimistically for their surrounding community and trying to really reach out to them, and then nothing happens. Could they be another arm supporting the preservation movement? Do you feel like they have been in the past?
Well, I mean, looking at our neighborhood, for instance, the Merchant's House, I think, is considered an integral part of the historic preservation story of the neighborhood. Not just in terms of the house itself, but they've actually been actively involved in advocacy beyond the bounds of the house. So I think it varies, but I certainly think that these kinds of institutions can play an important role. They can be inspirations, they can be sort of touchstones, they can serve the larger community and be a part of it, and be a part of that preservation effort and that storytelling effort. And I think you see that in a lot of other places as well. I mean, you know, in Greenwich Village, we're uniquely fortunate in that preservation is just so embedded in the DNA of the community that it's kind of the one thing that everybody agrees upon. I mean, it's a neighborhood where people are notoriously opinionated, and there's probably many things that they don't agree on, but that's the one thing that everybody does agree upon. It allows institutions like Merchant's House, which is a historic house, to be really interwoven and not have the sometimes sort of outsider presence that an institution like that in other circumstances can have.
I started in the historic house business a long time ago, and it's very tough. I mean, historic sites have unique challenges that are very, very practical. I mean, they never were visited all that often. There's the need to continue funding. There is the idea that perhaps you're telling a finite story, and how many times and how many new ways can you tell that story? And you actually aren't telling a finite story, but that's the sort of given the traditional historic house museum problem, dilemma. But for example, last year we started doing a lot of community parties out in the neighborhoods rather than making everyone come to Manhattan. And we were incredibly successful in using historic houses to get neighborhood activists to come to the house, even if they knew the house, even if they sort of like vaguely kind of, they're like, oh yeah, the Alice Austin house. But we got a lot of people from Staten Island just go to Alice Austin house. We're like, this is beautiful, you know? And we want to talk about zoning in Mount and trying to save Mount Manresa, the Jesuit sanctuary. And this is a historic house and this is historic preservation. So there's a really great friction there. And we had a wonderful experience at the Marsh Jamil Mansion, because, you know, Marsh Jamil Mansion is Washington's headquarters. It was Aaron Burr's house, et cetera, et cetera. And it actually is the house that helped inspire the movie Hamilton. Not the movie, it's going to be the movie, I'm sure. The musical, forgive me, the musical Hamilton. And a lot of people from Upper Manhattan, a lot of Upper Manhattan activists from Washington Heights, from Harlem, were always complaining that I was forcing them to go downtown, never went to Marsh Jamil. And it was great. It would have been even better if the Parks Department actually ever finished putting in their air conditioning. But that was a real experience and a way for people to reconnect and for those places to become nodes of story and community centers, which I think they should be.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'm interested in the role of the Landmark Preservation Committee, because theoretically, you know, even in a balkanized community, there would be some activists who knew and understood that, Andrew pointed out, you know, something beautiful and healthy is replaced by something ugly and unhealthy. You know, that it should be that activists could bring a case and the Landmark Preservation Committee is there to protect us, to save us from more Penn Station problems. But that's not happening. And is it because the, you know, like, what good does it do if they say, yeah, it was a landmark after the stakes have been driven in the old Robert Moses technique? So are there good guys on the Landmark Preservation, and will they help, or is that a lost cause?
Well, I would say it's definitely not a lost cause. And, you know, let me say this. Nobody or few people have been a bigger critic of the commission than I have. That said, I also believe that credit should be given where credit is due. They have taken on tough cases. They have, in many cases, worked very hard against opposition, sometimes very concerted opposition. I think there are people who are there, both on the staff and the commission, who are really dedicated preservationists who care about and who are passionate about it. I think there are others who aren't. That's not the reason why they're there. Let's keep in mind, at the end of the day, this is an agency that is appointed by the mayor, who is a inherently political creature. The mayor is responsible for what they do. So there is that push-pull. But, you know, let's also say that at the end of the day, we elect our mayor. So the policy that we get, we are responsible for. And, you know, right now, the preservation agenda has really not been as prominent as it should be in the citywide conversation about what New York City needs. And I think the actions of the commission in some ways reflect that. You know, we can get into whole other conversations about some great examples where the commission did really go out front and kind of put their money where their mouth was. There's clearly other cases where they said, you know what, it's too messy, it's too controversial, it's too difficult. There are vested interests here that don't want to see us do it, and they stepped aside. That is absolutely true. You're never going to have a pure commission. In a lot of ways, I would say at the end of the day, it's us. You know, we have to push the commission, we have to push our elected officials who appoint them to make preservation a priority.
I think it's slightly unfair to actually ask the city agency to be the, you know, just drive on sheer purity, because no city agency does. I mean, unfortunately,
The
fact of the matter is that that's why we are a citizenry, and that's why they need to respond to us, but they are not the leaders in that. They are the maintainers of it. They have the police authority, but they are balancing a huge number of things, and like all city agencies, are balancing a great deal of goods that and their own priorities that may not reflect what the activists and what we as the people necessarily want. Because we as the people, everyone who came out tonight to listen to a preservation lecture, has one point of view, but there are also 8 million other people in New York who also have different points of view that might not balance in the same way. So I think that it's very important. They need to be more responsive to the people who are their natural constituents. But I think that we need to hold them to high standards, but understand that they can't necessarily meet them, and understand they aren't the leaders necessarily. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I think I saw it then in the back.
Since you're talking about the next 50 years, one thing that seems definitely true is that modern technology of development has enabled like extremely tall buildings to go up all over town, taller than they were ever able to build before on narrower, smaller lots than they were ever able to get something like that up in here. And so that seems like it kind of scotches any deal of preserving anything, because, you know, just the shadows and the immense amount of money involved in those buildings. And I'm not sure what my question is, but I think that is something that I'm interested in hearing your thoughts about this new development of development. So,
you know, I would just say that while clearly technology continues to change, I think the much more dramatic factor in New York has not been the change in the technology, but the change in the economy. And the fact that there's so much more money to be made in these developments in so many more places. Now, the technology can make it a little bit cheaper and a little bit easier, but I really think that it's the overall economic changes that are driving the massive pressure that you're seeing in so many more places of the city for change. And, you know, to be perfectly honest, we have to recognize that that is a factor and that it's with us now. Who knows what the future holds? I mean, you know, if we went back in a time capsule just 10 or 15 years and showed people what was going on in New York today, I think most people would say, you're crazy, that could never be. Who knows what 10 or 15 years from now will hold, but right now we do have a raging real estate economy, and we have to deal with that. It obviously makes preservation particularly challenging, but not impossible. You know, there was a very big critic of the prior administration on a whole bunch of fronts, but they were, in some respects, vigorous about preservation. They were also vigorous about development, and that usually came first. It is possible for this administration to be equally, if not more, vigorous about preservation, and we need to get them there.
Thank you. I
just sort of want to look at the huge picture, which includes things like federal housing dollars, which in the South Bronx built acres of two-family houses where they probably would have been better off building five-story buildings and increasing density, because you need a certain density if you want certain services, having said that. And then we have this interesting situation going right on, right now, in front of our noses, with the money laundering on the super expensive apartments in the center of Manhattan, which is a lot of fun, especially with Panama. So my point or question or whatever is, I think, I don't know if you can politically push on all these fronts, but I think maybe one has to. That's it.
I mean, I kind of feel like that was the subtext of a lot of what I was saying. And that, again, I don't operate from that big a level, but I see it again and again, especially in my field of geography, that if you really want to change these issues, you have to think big and move in a sort of concerted society-wide movement that addresses multiple issues at once. Because if you address one issue, then the problem just goes somewhere else.
What I'm really trying to say is when you talk to the mayor, say blah, 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 he's in addition to blah, blah, blah. In other words, give him an alternative. When he says, I need extra housing, you say, well, yeah, well, go tear down X number of acres of those two family houses that were put up, often very, very recently, on lots by the Federal Housing Authority to create housing, but it doesn't create housing. Creates housing for two families. Well, if you put up something that was the same height as elementary school and took up the whole block, maybe you'd have room for a lot more families. So instead of your children, you know, you got my children. Mm-hmm. We're talking Lock Haven in this case.
And that obviously involves, you know, urban planners and their use of the space and a critical question that I often have as a citizen of New York is, do you have to build that there? You know?
Exactly.
Where you can put,
I've sort of been involved in a nasty battle of the art students with Excel Corporation. And I was Frank Mason's monitor for 10 years. I attended many James Bell talks. And I think if those two were alive now, they would be outraged. It is really ghastly. It's awful. And I attended a meeting there last night, and they had a new financial advisor who referred to the students as consumers when they said they're going to raise the tuition. And meanwhile, they're sitting on all this money that from the air rights. But ultimately, what I'm asking is, you know, you can't do anything about that because of the big money in the city, and Excel certainly qualifies for the big money. But there's rumor that the actual structure could be compromised with cracks. And there's also rumor that maybe down the line it would just do away with the art students because it's going to perhaps be, once again, compromised. I mean, the Northlight studios that were glorious, glorious, are gone. And they say like in 5 years perhaps they'll come back. And I look out the window and it's like this now. And it's almost an ethereal thing I think one of you guys are talking about. It's like you're going to be teaching generations of students, but they're not going to have this North Light effect. You're not going to be learning that. So it's almost such a disservice to the painting of that sort of thing. But also, the fact that the administration is growing and growing, and it's almost like it's a league, it's supposed to be the members and the students, and now it's the administration's versus the student body. So it's really quite curious, because I think it morphs into something else.
It's a real estate deal.
Yeah, but it's like so awful. You think the people who aren't students would say, yeah, this is awful, you know, what are they doing? And then they're almost like, oh, it's so incredulous. And what do you think about that? Basically, I'm asking what you think the whole thing is.
I guess I'm the only one who can really. And I do not, I've spoken with some of the people who are protesting at the Art Students League. We did testify against the Nordstrom Tower, which we thought was horrible, a terrible precedent, a stupid, stupid decision by the Landmarks Commission. I understand that there were lawsuits, but I mean, I'm not an expert in what's going on there at the moment and the internal discussions, and I've never gone to a meeting of the league itself, so I can only say from the outside, it looks like one of these terrible, terrible decisions that is being driven by economic fears, perhaps, or economic greed, or that sort of thing, and that's like, the limit, and I don't know. I mean, the answer is, I don't know what can be done, and it's really horrible.
We have time for just one more question.
Yeah. When you say, Andrew, we have to push our elected
elected officials.
so we have to push them to make Denmark a priority. But I assume you're aware at the same time that it will never be a priority, because New York has always been a city where it's mostly about growth, where it's mostly about money. I may like it or not, but that's what always made New York tick from the very beginning when it was in Amsterdam. So it will always take a back stage, and of course you have to push, but it will never be a priority, but that makes it even more important to push, because otherwise it will go underground. So I think the city is just built on money, and you can call it greed, but it's a reality. That's what makes this city tick, and if it didn't have this money, New York would go under. That's the other side.
Sure. Look, we live in a capitalist society, and you know, in many ways, New York is the center of capitalism. Wall Street is here. There is enormous amounts of money to be made in real estate, and that is a tremendously powerful factor. You know, I would just say, if you look at the things that we've all been able to accomplish, not just at this dais, but everybody who cares about this issue over the last couple years, and if you think, what if we hadn't pushed for that? What if we hadn't done that? How much dramatically different this city would look if we hadn't? And I think very much for the worse. And you know, I would also say that as powerful as those forces are, by far the majority of the rules at the end of the day are arrived at by people at City Hall who are elected by us. We have more power than we give ourselves credit for. I do think we need to recognize that a lot of the values that we're talking about here today, we may feel strongly about, or we may get. A lot of other people either don't feel strongly about it or don't see the connections. So to a certain degree, we have to work harder to make sure that the people who make up the city, who, among other things, are ultimately electing our decision makers, get how important this is. And I think we have work to be done there. We've accomplished a lot, but we're clearly up against a lot, and we're never not going to be up against a lot, for sure.
And I think that one of the things that's happened, in fact, as we are dealing with this incredible level of wealth being poured into the city, kind of willy-nilly, is that there's a more and more popular appreciation for the authenticity of New York, for what we have left, because it is so endangered. I think actually, over the last 15 years, I've seen more people are more engaged in and understand that we're losing so much. So it's our job, it's everyone's job, and it's our job as advocates and everyone's job who cares about these things, to communicate, to understand that you can do things, and that what you are losing is important, and it needs to be lost.
Yeah, and I mean, even when you talk about the organization, like the lower east side, and when you said in Greenwich, it's much easier because there is more homogeneity, but it is also the homogeneity of money. I mean, there is more upper middle class money in Greenwich than traditionally on the lower east side. So.
Well, I just want to say, I wasn't saying that in Greenwich Village it was homogeneity. I said that there was sort of a consensus around the importance of preservation. And it's absolutely true that Greenwich Village has skewed towards the upper end of the economic spectrum. But that consensus around historic preservation has been there for generations, when it was a much less wealthy neighborhood. So it's very much rooted in the culture of this community, and it's continued to be rooted in the culture of that community when it was a less affluent community, and now that it's a more affluent community as well. So I don't think it's socioeconomically specific.
Thank you. Can I ask if any of you have any last comments or thoughts?
Yeah, we need more research.
And we need more of you to participate in this and help work on
Well, I want to thank you so much for joining me tonight, especially our speakers. I'm incredibly humbled and also very motivated now just hearing each of you speak and engaging in discussion with you. Thank you so much. This was great.